The sponsors of this webinar today are the Alliance for Global Justice, Chicago Alba Solidarity, Orinoco Tribune, Task Force on the Americas, Alberta Lovera Bolivarian Circle of New York, the Frente para la Defensa de Pueblos Hugo Chavez in Canada, the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, the Canadian Peace Congress, the Portland Central America Solidarity Committee, the Committee on Latin America in Columbus, Ohio, Sanctions Kill Coalition, U.S. Peace Council, Code Pink, the Louis Riel Bolivarian Circle in Toronto, Common Frontiers in Canada, the Pacific Northwest Solidarity with Latin America and the Caribbean, and the LELO, the Legacy of Equality Leadership and Organizing, and finally the CASA Baltimore Lima. The speakers today are Jesus Rodriguez and William Camacaro. Both are Venezuelan who have been living in Venezuela for almost at least for 1 year. They've been there for Jesus maybe 2 or 3 years ago. William Camacaro's been there about a year. They are well known in the U.S. for their years of work defending Venezuela's sovereignty and chavismo while living in New York and Chicago. The question and answer will be by Roger Harris, a longtime activist with the Task Force on the Americas, and Nino Paglizia with the Venezuelan Canadian with the Frente para la Defensa de Pueblos Hugo Chavez. Jesus Rodriguez, as many people know, worked in the consulate of Bolivarian Venezuela in Chicago. In several years of this time, he was the head of the consulate. He is now the editor of the excellent English language website, Orinoco Tribune, which has the best and most thorough daily information on Venezuela of, I think, of any website you could find today. We encourage all listeners here to financially support Orinoco Tribune during this very difficult time for Venezuelans having to live under this U.S. blockade. William Camacaro has been an exemplary and hardworking Venezuelan solidarity, as many people know. He's organized many tours and delegations to Venezuela and operates the Facebook group Venezuela Solidarity New York. He's been a central and invaluable leader in the movement in the U.S. and is certainly one of the most well-known, activist leader in New York.
Okay. Thank you very much for the introduction, Stan. I think that's better than the introduction that I did for myself. I just want to say that I came last January 1st. To Venezuela, and I came first with a delegation from United States, from New York, and I decided to stay 3-4 months I came here because I'm working in a special program called Manitos, organized by Alliance for Global Justice. Manitos is a program that is trying to bring seeds to the peasant movement from to the Venezuelan peasants, no? So I have been doing that work for all this time here. And for me, it has been very interesting because although I have been coming to Venezuela 3 or 4 times, it's not the same to stay and drive around and know what really people are facing daily in these special economy times that the country is facing. I think that I'm going just to make go over a big number of stuff that are going on right now in the country that made the victory of this past election something incredibly important and something something that a lot of people don't understand. Because the economy situation that people are facing, but also will help us to understand why we had this number of people that didn't go to vote. First of all, we have an economy that has been completely dollarized. People are using dollar for everything. People are buying everything in dollars. And when you go even to get hacked up in the street, you can pay in dollar. To pay your bills, almost everything you can pay here now in dollars. people have a salary that probably could be a minimum wage, for example, could be $3, $4 for around that per month. People also, we have a big problem because we don't have a Venezuelan currency. It's very difficult to get bolivares in Venezuela. We don't have Venezuelan currency. You need it to pay, for example, public transportation, or if you are driving, to pay a toll. But it's very the scarcity of Venezuela's currency is something that is affecting the entire economy and everybody here. Also, we have a big problem with the gasoline. People can spend hours, days, especially outside of Caracas, because as I said, I always say, Caracas is a bubble. It's the best, you know, it's not facing the same reality that other cities around the country are facing. In Caracas, you can get maybe, you can be in a line maybe one day, we can be in a line maybe 5 hours, 6 hours. But if you go to, for example, San Carlos, you could be in a line waiting, trying to get some gasoline 20 days. To get some gasoline for your car. And people made turns in between their families members. They, one day stay a niece, another day stay your brother, another day stay someone from the family to save the place, to save the spot, and to save the car while you're waiting to be able to get gasoline. The other big problem that people are facing here is the electricity. We have a lot of blackout all over the countries. Could be 3 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours, 12, 24 hours, 48 hours, blackout. I was just in Valencia, I'm right now in Caracas, but I came 2 days ago from Valencia, and we have just a few days ago, 12 hours blackout. And that made everything very difficult because if you have 12 hours blackout, you don't have gas to cook. You have your electricity kitchen to cook. So you cannot cook anything. So what has been happening with this situation, the first thing that happened is that because the blackout, there was no gas to cook, people start to get electricity, kitchen electricity, the electric kitchen, so to cook in the houses. But then the entire electric system start to get saturated. And you start to get more blackout because everybody is using those electricity kitchen. So as a consequence, people start to make their own stove. Their stove with the firewood. People organize all over the country. They call themselves female male stove makers. So they made stove, all kinds of stove with clay, with brick, with cement, with all kinds of material, metals. And it's a very interesting to see how people are basically supporting each other to make all this stove all over the country. You can see how people are passing information through the social media to learn how to make all this stuff and to cook, to be able to cook. And you can see people are making all this big stuff to make a kitchen for Bolivarian school that provide food to people in the neighborhood. That's something really that talk a lot about the social organization and the grassroots movement in Venezuela, because this is something that is completely organic, organized by people themselves, where even the government don't have any participation. It's just the grassroots movement finding solution to the problem of the economy warfare and the blockade of the United States against the Bolivarian Revolution. basically, this year, I feel, have been one of the most tough year against the Bolivarian Revolution. We have President Maduro, the First Lady, for example, indicted by the United States, and several other members of the National Assembly. We have a big number of sanctions that have been imposed this year against the Venezuelan government and against the Venezuelan people. A big number of new economy sanctions that basically are trying to destroy the Bolivarian Revolution. But the good thing is that although in some occasion you can see that you don't see any initiative from the government, the good thing is that you see initiative from the grassroots movement. And that's very important. I really feel that this extension mean a lot, because mean that people still trust the government, mean despite all the chaos that is taking place, thanks to the sanctions and to the blockade, but also we have to say that's in part also the corruption is a big problem here. And people understand that, but despite the corruption, despite all the sanctions, the blockade, people decide to support the Bolivarian Revolution because they understand that the best thing to do is to support and to continue with the revolution. I would say that also it's something that is amazing thing to see, because you can see that although the daily life of a Venezuelan could be a nightmare, go to the bank could be a nightmare to get some money, to get a few bolivares, you can be waiting for hours to get few bolivares in the bank and make a big line with 200, 300 people. You can be, to go to a building to the 8th-10th floor, you probably have to walk up because the elevator are not working. Things like that happen every day. The subway system sometimes is shut down, it's not working, or work so slow, or work not as we used to work because they don't have the parts to prepare the subway. But despite everything, despite that people even walk to work to go to work because they don't have enough money to pay the public transportation, despite that, people decide to support the Bolivarian Revolution. That means that there is some level of consciousness too. I don't know, I have some pictures. I don't know if we can see some of those pictures, because I want to make sure that people understand what the grassroots movement and the and is trying. I don't know how to work with this pictures. How people are making this stuff to cook and to. For example, this one is one. This one is one that I made because I am in one of those groups. I have been here for more than almost a year. So I have been with chatting and visiting all this group of people that are working with us, this kind of stuff. So, and I learned how to make that kind of apparatus thanks to their support. This is another kind of stove. This is a kind of stove, very simple to use in the backyard. It's very and also this is a very interesting. There is a big consciousness of to work with the stove and use of firewood in an ecological way. People even are learning how to create some kind of stuff with organic material so that they can use as a firewood and don't cut trees and things like that. People even have been passing information about what happened in Haiti when they were cooking with, when they were basically cooking with firewood. This is another example. This is something that I was able to see the entire process, how they made this kitchen that is with firewood that you can use. And this is used in the backyard of the house. And people basically have everything to cook there. And they don't have to really face the uncomfortable smoke that usually is coming from those machines because they don't use too much firewood. also, I don't know what's going on here. Okay. I don't know if we have more of this, but this is the kind of material that I have been able to see. The people, this is another firewood kitchen that people are doing in their places. And they, in even firewood, well, this is when I was doing my own stuff. I have the support of several friends from the United States. They sent me some money. So I decided to do with the extra money to do some stuff to cook. So I made more than 7 of these apparatus to really, I was sitting for more than 6 hours cutting that metal and putting everything together to be able to do all this, fogones or stove or firewood stove. And basically I made several, and I bring 3 of those firewood stove to some friend that live in Junquito, because in El Junquito, that is a very close area to Caracas, and the way to the Junquito, there are a lot of people that don't have gas to cook. So basically that is something for me that is very optimistic, despite all the economy warfare, despite all the internal problems that the government is facing, despite everything, people are trying to find solutions to their own problems, and people understand that the main cause of the economy difficulties that people are facing is because the economy warfare, the blockade, the financial blockade that the United States has been implementing against Venezuela.
Okay, great. Great. I believe that, thank you for inviting me, first of all, to speak today. And thank you for the kind introduction, Stan. And I'm going to take what William said, and I'm going to use it like to analyze the results of the recent parliamentary elections in Venezuela. I believe that what at the end, what William was trying to let us know is that the material circumstances that we Venezuelans, the majority of Venezuelans are facing are tough, are very unusual, are not the circumstances of the voting situation or framework in Romania or in Switzerland or in Canada. I mean, we are in the middle of a war. I mean, we have been living through this at least to this crazy level for the last 2 or 3 years. But besides that, Venezuela, I mean, the Venezuelans were able to say to the U.S. Mainly that we don't want them to decide who is the president and who are the authorities in Venezuela. So what I'm going to do now is like to share with you a slide that I prepared with some information regarding the numbers for the electoral contest. The first things that you should be seeing there is the voting machine. In early this year, there was a big fire. Some people call it a sabotage, in which most of the old voting machines that we use got burned. So the CNE, the Venezuelan Electoral Authority, already was in a process of procuring new machines. So what they did after the fire was that they speed up the whole process, and they distributed all those new machines all over Venezuela for these parliamentary elections, and that is the machine that you see in the image. I'm going to try to explain to you basically what we voted for. I don't know if you see my pointer, but basically the pointer, I'm trying to circle the pointer around the parties that support Chavismo. They are basically the ones in the upper side, and the only one that is currently, I'm not saying that it's not supporting Chavismo, but it's not running the same card with Chavismo, is the Communist Party of Venezuela. And those in the lower side of the image that I'm circling right now are mostly opposition parties. So that's to give you an idea of what we voted for. If you ask me how did I vote it, I usually voted in Venezuela PCV, But this time I decided to cross vote between, I mean, I voted this election. I have to tell you that was kind of complicated. It has been always been complicated, but this time was more complicated because in these elections, we choose like three levels of voting for these parliamentary elections. We voted for a national list that is designed for each party with a list of names that of candidates that are running for the parliament. And then we voted for a regional list with the same design, but for design for each state. And then we voted for a regional list, but I mean, for a regional option that was not a list, that was nominal. I mean, in which you choose the candidate by name. So it was kind of complicated in this election. We also had like and the number of positions open moved from 167, I believe, to 290 something. And that was mainly because of the requests. These changes, most of these changes happened because of the requests of the opposition parties in the national dialogue table that led to the somehow to the call of these parliamentary elections. What I'm showing you right now is the latest. Distribution of seats that the National Electoral Authority, the CNE, posted in its website. You can go right now to the CNE website and you can see by yourself the results of the elections at each state, in each municipality, in each parish, in each voting center. You have all the detail of the election at your hands. And that's one of the most amazing things that we have in our electoral system here in Venezuela. So basically what you see here, there is like the majority of the National Assembly, the rectangles in red are the ones that belongs to the PSUV, and then you have like some seats that are in gray that are not assigned yet. And you have one in yellow and one in purple that you can see here what they are referred to. Basically, this is the latest update on the elections, at least at the moment that I was preparing the slides. And basically, you see there that the percentage of seats, which is not the same as the percentage of votes for the PSUV, represents almost 72%, at least for now. So I believe that maybe tomorrow or today there will be another update with the final results. But that gives you an idea of what happened here. This other slide shows you somehow the first approach to the results. This was an estimation prepared by a Venezuelan newspaper, but I believe that they prepared this infographic with the help using the percentages, the initial percentages that you that the CNE reported. But you can see there that, for example, that the PCV, the Communist Party, got like six seats, which is not true. Actually, the last update that I saw only talked about one seat that the Venezuelan Communist Party won, at least for now. But it gives you an idea of the basically of the complete control of the PSUV forces over the parliament. And I have to tell you that we call mayoría absoluta, like I don't know how to say in English, but it might be absolute majority or I don't know how to say, but in Venezuela by law you need 66%, two-thirds of the parliament seats. So right now the PSUV seems to have more than that, and if you ask me, I believe that was not the best option. I was thinking that maybe with 60% was going to be nice for the PSUV in order to be able to negotiate with other political organizations. But if you see it from the PSUV side, you will realize that it actually helped us a lot in order to advance legislation and projects and legislative activities that are needed in order to advance. So this slide shows you the most updated results that I mentioned you with the PCV, the Communist Party with one seat, other parties with five, this BUVP, VPA group is from the opposition and they got two seats, and the biggest opposition group from ADECO, PEI, CMC, AP, El Cambio, they got 89 seats, and of course the PSUV, Gran Polo Patriótico, got 177 seats. This is the most accurate representation that I found like 1 hour before this webinar. So I wanted to show you that. And just to finish, I wanted to show you how the evolution of the votes in Venezuela has been behaving in recent elections. I believe that's important because a lot of people, especially from the Chavista side, we criticize ourselves too much, sometimes too much. I saw a very nice group of numbers, statistic by one guy in Twitter yesterday, in which he was saying that basically that we Chavistas should ask ourselves what happened with us, why we jumped from almost 8 million votes to 3 or 4 million votes. And this slide shows you that it is not as bad as he said. Actually, it's true that the number of Chavista votes got reduced in this election. And for that, I believe that what William said is very important. I mean, there's a lot of exhaustion among Chavistas, but also among anti-Chavistas. Every Venezuelan is suffering from these sanctions and from this U.S. blockade. So, and the economic crisis that this thing has created in terms of services, in terms of prices, salaries, everything. What I did today was to collect the numbers of how the opposition vote behaved in the last elections. And you can see very clearly there that the opposition votes for these elections behave worse than the Chavista reduction in votes. So basically you can see there like a big drop in the anti-Chavista vote for these elections. And this is the last slide in which basically you can see the numbers instead of the graphic. And basically what I'm trying to tell you is that if you compare the 2018 presidential election with the 2020 presidential election from the Chavista side, there was, the Chavista vote in this election represented 68% of the Chavista vote during the presidential elections in 2018. And that's a reduction, but I believe if you ask me that reduction is the result of what William was saying and that I've been saying about the exhaustion and the situations that we have right now. And then you see the anti-Chavista vote in which their behavior was worse than, the anti-Chavista vote in this election represented only 46% of the votes they got in the 2018 presidential election. So that gives you an idea on how bad the situation was. I'm trying to go back to the video. I'm not sure if I'm there, but basically that's what I wanted to tell you. I wanted to show you some numbers right now. To summarize, Chavismo, PSUV, GPP have the control, absolute control of the parliament. And we hope that that will help in the coming months or years to try to build the path for a economic recovery. But no, I cannot fool myself that everything is gonna depend on the parliament, because the reality is that we are still facing a very aggressive attack from the US and Europe, and I don't expect it to ease in the coming months. But at least having control of the parliamentary election from the political also point of view eliminates, kills, politically talking, Guaido projects, disregarding whatever media and mediatic show they want to present in mainstream media about Guaido for some magical reason being forever the president of the National Assembly. The reality is that he is not going to be anymore. I mean, he actually is not the president of the National Assembly, but in January 5th, he actually won't be a deputy for the National Assembly. So any crazy argument, because already the argument that he was interim president or something like that, but that was very crazy. But anyway, I believe that that politically talking will internally, in terms of politics inside Venezuela, represents a lot. Represents a lot the killing, the political elimination of the Guaido project, the message that we are sending that we don't want to, that Chavismo is still a solid force that can mobilize, even in the middle of this crazy situation, more than 4 million people to vote for them. And that's it. I believe that that we should go to the question and answers, and I should stop talking. Thank you for inviting us. And please read Orinoco Tribune. Bye-bye.
William, the first question is for you. And the question has to do with what is the overall mood of the Venezuelan people regarding this election and the U.S. blockade? Has something changed with December 6th? And if so, what is that?
You know, I came to Venezuela for the presidential election. And I remember that I was in the center of the city in a bar a few days before the elections. And people were, everybody were talking very badly about Maduro before the presidential election. And everybody was upset about the economy situation and everything that was happening. So I was a little nervous when I spoke to some of my friends. They said, well, do you think that people are going to vote for Maduro? And a friend of mine, yes, you know, people are going to vote for Maduro. So Maduro won the election. Then a few days after, I was again in the same bar and the same people, well, they were saying that they vote and they were talking again Maduro again. But they basically were saying, no, we can talk bad about him because he's our. Because, he, you know, that's what people see, everything. They have the right to talk badly because they feel that he is coming from the movement. And I feel that, yes, there is a lot of people angry, people are upset because it's very difficult to face all these difficulties every day. But at the end, people understand that the sanctions and the financial economy blockade are critical in all this economic disaster that we are living right now.
People want to get a better sense of what Venezuelans expect from the U.S. with the change of administration in the U.S. How is that being viewed in Venezuela with Biden becoming the new president and Trump leaving?
Yes, I got the question. I mean, basically, I mean, if you ask a Chavista from every, you know, political tendency within Chavismo, if I can say that, they will tell you that there's no a big hope of improvement in relations with the elections in the U.S. We don't see Biden. Most of the Chavistas believe that Republicans and Democrats are the same. Most of the Chavistas believe, at least in my case, I believe as a Chavista that Joe Biden is the most conservative wing of the Democratic Party, and that put him very close to Donald Trump. Of course, he's a Democrat, and they try to play the game of the good cop and the bad cop, if we can put it that way. And usually the bad cops are the Republicans and the good cops are the Democrats. But at the end of the day, they always want to screw us. Excuse me for my English. So if you ask me, that's the opinion that I have. That's my own opinion, but that's the opinion that I believe most of the Chavista people have. When you analyze the whole political spectrum in Venezuela, you see that there's a lot of pushing, especially among those progressive right-wingers, if you can call them that. Those that have access to media, that those that you can hear in radios or TV stations from the right wing, and they talk a lot about that Maduro have to take advantage of the situation in the U.S. and try to promote a dialogue or something. And I believe that that's a dream of those liberals, very similar to the dream of most liberals in the U.S. that believe that something good can come out of a democratic government. So that's how I see it. I mean, among the progressive right-wingers, there's some expectation, but the majority of the Venezuelans do not see, Chavismo do not see it like a good thing.
I think that most of the people are not waiting anything from Biden. In fact, I was talking to some friends and they were just telling me, hey, around 74 million people voted for Trump in the United States. That means that around 74 million people think the same way that Trump. And then I don't think that the country is going to change at all. So we don't have anything to expect. They basically said from the Biden administration and even from the people from the United States, because half of the people basically are like Trump. So, and that was a very strong statement because yes, it's a very incredible, for me it was incredible to see how many people vote for Trump, especially when you think that when you see the way that he handled the pandemic in the United States. I was expecting to see, you know, very small number of people voting for Trump just for that reason. And no, that didn't happen. So that made everybody feel a little excited about any USA administration.
How has the government handled the COVID-19 crisis? How are people doing and stuff like that? Can you give us some insights here?
Yes, I feel that it's obviously, this is a country that is completely isolated. It's a country that is in a situation that is facing a financial blockade. And of course, we have a scarcity of some medical stuff. That's undoubtedly. But despite everything, I believe that the Venezuelan government has been doing everything possible to protect the Venezuelan people, the population. And one of the first things that the President Maduro did, I think that was very effective, is to close the border. Immediately we have two, three, four cases, no more than four cases, the border were closed. And we went into quarantine for several months. That was very important thing. But at the same time, this is my impression, I feel like Venezuela was isolated. We didn't have any airplane coming from United States. The only one airline that was coming to Venezuela was Copa and was coming through Panama. So we don't have tourism here for a long time already. And we had, I think, that only one flight coming from Europe, one per week. So that's something that indirectly helped us to move through these difficult times that we faced during the pandemic. There also, I feel that in the beginning, more in the beginning, people were taking care of themselves and they were protecting, and all the call that the state was putting in the media through the national TV, through the radio, was very well understood by the people in the country, and they were protecting themselves. And I would say that that happened in the first 3-4 months. People were really taking care of themselves and their communities. I think that now people are more relaxed, something that is raising some concerns here, because people are not using the mask and not taking the same measure that they were taking several months ago. But and just in a few words, yes, I feel that the government has been doing everything possible to basically protect the Venezuelan population from the virus.
William, we're getting a whole number of constellation of questions all around the various political groups within the electoral arena there. And so some of these questions relate to the right wing, the opposition, what's happening with Guaido, how many people have boycotted, how many people participated in the opposition, what is that dynamic? And then on the other side, there's been divisions also within, or independence within, the Chavista formation, and if you can address that as well.
Because people are angry with the government, some people are upset because of the economic situation that they face. Sometimes you can get into in public transportation, you can see all these wise old people handling some flyers to people in the street. And you can see sometimes people in the poor neighborhood saying, I'm not going to vote for Maduro, but I'm not going to vote for Guaido. So that kind of stuff, you can see that kind of reaction from some people in the street. So if some people don't, because the economy situation are upset with Maduro, some people are extremely angry with Guaido. So I don't see any future for Guaido in Venezuela. I think that after this election, something that is very good that happened, and I think that was very smart from the Venezuelan government, was the construction of a new opposition that is not a new opposition that is calling for intervention, and that's calling for also U.S. More sanctions to Venezuela. This is something that people have to understand. This new opposition are against, until now, because we don't know in the future, but until now, they have been vocally and loudly opposing to the sanctions and to also to any military intervention in Venezuela. That's something extremely important, because that is the main tool that the radical right wing conducted and leading by Guaido are using against the Venezuelan people: the sanctions and the financial blockade and the possible military intervention. So I don't think that they have any possibility, political possibility in the future in Venezuela. And I feel that the door is getting open to incarcerate Guaido in the near future, maybe after January, and to really get some of the people that were requesting sanctions and military actions against Venezuela, some of those people that used the National Assembly to attack his own people. So probably they will face some penalty, and some of them probably will go to prison. So that's something that's coming. I think that some of them will be incarcerated. Hopefully, I hope that this happens as soon as possible, because you know, we don't want United States to put more money on the hand of these crazy people.
There has been accusations of corruption within the Chavista ranks. It's been a delicate topic, but you would be the person who would be best to be able to address that. Can you tell us something about that, and what are the issues, and what are the concerns and solutions?
Well, one of the problems, and this is very important, this election, the result of this election, that, you know, we have almost 70% of the people didn't vote. That doesn't mean that 70% of the people are from the opposition. That means that there was a big number of the Chavistas that they didn't vote because they are not happy. And most of them, I would say, are not happy because of the corruption. it's very important. Okay, Jesus is here finally. it's very important for people here in Venezuela to see some figures that have been accused for the last few years of corruption in jail. So, and you don't see any well-known politician incarcerated for corruption in the country. So people get upset and angry. So you got a bunch of rumors of this minister or this person is in corruption, but no one is really incarcerated. But you can see how, for example, the food system in the entire country was completely dismantled. You can see how Mercado was completely dismantled. And you can see and have some idea that in the middle of everything, there was a big corruption. So that made everybody feel angry because they don't see any person blame for and taking responsibility for what's going on, what happened, especially with those two programs that were Chavez created and were very appreciated by the majority of the population. I feel that this coming year, the government has to move and fight corruption and demonstrate to the population that yes, they are willing to fight the corruption, even if the corruption is coming from people in their own party. And it's very important to gain back the support of all those Chavistas that didn't vote this time. And we need them to win the presidential election. I think that the government has to start to clean the house and to make sure that everybody will see and will get the message.
What is the international significance of this election in Venezuela and of the Bolivarian project? How is that impacting the rest of the countries in Latin America, the events in Bolivia, the events in Chile, which have been great advances and a new dawn in a way for Latin America? Where is the pink tide going at this point? And I'll ask Jesus to address that first and then maybe William afterward.
Yes, the way I see it is that this victory is an inspiration for leftists disregarding what the media is trying to present about the parliamentary elections. I mean, it's a victory and an inspiration. And I believe that in that sense, most of the progressive forces around the region, but also around the world, that's the way they see the results of the parliamentary elections. And I believe that that will have an impact in the upcoming presidential elections in Ecuador that are about to happen. I believe that they are scheduled for January or February, and also for the constitutional work that is going to happen. It's going to start soon in Chile. So I believe that is very positive from outside Venezuela. But if you ask me from inside Venezuela, I mean, we Chavistas see it as a possible signal because it will allow us to do a lot of things that we were not able to do while the National Assembly was in the hands of the opposition, but also because we at least are going to get rid of that crazy political opposition of Venezuela that did something that no other opposition in our history have done, which is basically sell themselves to the U.S., and beg for sanctions and for invasion. I mean, that's not very common in political opposition here in Venezuela, and I believe that in anywhere in the world. So we are going to at least get rid of them from position of power. They are going to remain there, but at least they won't have the same authorities that they that they had until today. You can add to that, William.
And William?
Yes, I feel like this election definitely is going to impact the progressive movement in the continent. As the Bolivian result did, I think that this is going to be to have an effect in, for example, in Ecuador, as to say, but also everybody in the continent is right now talking about constituent assembly. So people are talking in the grassroots movement in Colombia to have a constituent assembly, to organize a constituent assembly in Colombia, in Ecuador, in Peru. Now we have one in Chile coming soon. So it's something that basically start in Venezuela. It's something that it's an old idea, but Venezuela, I feel it was the first one to implement something like that, and have been, and everybody is right now in the continent trying to see how they can do it in their own country, how they can reform the constitution and make something and build rebuild their nations. I think that that's very important. I feel like this is going to definitely impact in Brazil, especially it's going to impact in United States. They probably are rethinking everything that have been doing against Venezuela, and also all their support that they have been providing to Guaido and all his criminal gangs. So this is something that really I feel like is going to rebuild the entire movement, and probably we will have, because everybody is talking already, the UNASUR, the river of the UNASUR in the future and the coming in the near future is something that Evo Morales has been talking, Fernandez in Brazil has been talking, and the Mexican president has been talking, and Venezuelan president has been talking. So it's something that, so the reconstruction of what was destroyed during the Obama era, I think that's coming now.
Nino is a Venezuelan. He's living in Canada. He's an activist and a writer, and he is with the Frente para la Defensa de los Pueblos, Hugo Chavez, and a great comrade. Nino, if you could please close us out. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Roger, and greetings and hello to everyone. As you just mentioned, Roger, I think our speakers have sort of tried to answer many questions, but they also raise a lot of questions that we have to process over time. We just had the pleasure, in fact, of listening to Jesus Rodriguez, a Venezuelan editor of the online outlet Orinoco Tribune, and Venezuelan American activist William Camacaro, both reporting from Venezuela about some very important details about the recent elections that took place in Venezuela last December 6th. William Camacaro, in my view, gave us the context under which the election took place. He gave us a clear message that the conditions on the ground were not normal, considering the tremendous hardship on the population that he described. Now, these conditions, we know, are caused by the U.S., Canadian, European sanctions, economic war, and it was mentioned the U.S. threats of military intervention against the Bolivarian Revolution. Now, in the day-to-day difficulties that we have heard cannot be minimized to the government mismanagement. So we are all left with the basic question: if the illegal sanctions and other economic coercive measures do not have an impact, why are they issued to start with? A related question is, if the US, Canada, and the European Union want to show their displeasure with the Venezuelan government. Are there diplomatic means to do so within international law and charters? So those are some of the questions. Now, on the other hand, Jesus Rodriguez spoke to us about the election itself and gave us an analysis of the process that the results, so we can interpret and understand the meaning and the implications. So we'll take some time to process that. I also hope that Jesus eventually would publish these comments, his comments, to the on the Orinoco Tribune, and we hope to read that soon. Now, despite the harsh conditions that William referred to, the National Assembly needed to be elected this year. And we need to remember that. And I think it was implicit in what the presenters told us. It is a constitutional mandate. So by all account, the election has been deemed a democratic process that was needed, and it was issued from, and it was ratified by hundreds of observers in Venezuela. We have heard that opposition parties were well represented and that only those who called for a boycott on the elections did not participate. Their choice cannot invalidate the election, and we have to remember that. So again, we need to ask ourselves, what motivates the US, Canada, and the European Union to declare a fraud before the election took place? More importantly, how can they explain the contradiction of preventing an election to take place at the same time that they claim to protect democracy in Venezuela? Jesus gave us an indication that Venezuelans have made an electoral decision to continue with the Bolivarian process. But I am sure that the analysis of the Bolivarian process in Venezuela and in Latin America will be going on for some time, and we're looking forward to that.